Have you ever wondered why your child comes and tells you, "Mama, I never want to study again"? Maybe it is because he feels his teachers don't like him? Or is it because he feels he's not good enough? Or maybe he thinks that he is not keeping up with his peers? To answer such questions, come and join us on our FB Live on November 14th by Team Banjara, led by Dr.Ali at 11 a.m. Since it being Children's Day and Diwali, gift yourself that little gift of how to enhance your relationship with your child. See you soon.
Only and only Daddy can shout. No, okay, Mama. When you hear this, how will you feel? I know it's not the most important now, but you know how much efforts you can have given, and this is what you have to learn and not to get answers to such questions that you don't know and your mind cannot think. What can be the reason why you feel such things? You can get this mana gift for yourself on this Saturday, 14th November, which is a Children's Day event, on Facebook Live with Banjara Academy. A gift for yourself, for the family, to make things better for yourself. End of the day, it's you who matters.
Always respect toys, you go through the pages of my favorite comic book. And whenever I come and tell you what he is doing, you always support him. I doubt whether you love me at all. I think only Mama loves you. So this reason I need to share all my things with my younger brother. But then he is always troubling me and I don't like it at all. I'm wondering where did he come from? And I wish I did not have a younger brother at all. These could be complaints or messages from your children about their siblings. This is a common thing that happens to many of you. You want to find out how to handle this situation, how to help them. Join us on FB Live on 14 at 11 a.m. and give yourself this Diwali a better understanding of your children. The topic is, you are the worst mama in the world. But as you saw in this video, it could also be your worst mama in this world. Whatever it is, come and join us and get a good understanding of the children and how you can work with them.
Hi, B.
dear parent, what does your little one mean when he or she tells you, you are the worst mama in this world? A familiar statement, have you heard it any time? It could possibly mean that you have been a little strict and you are standing to your ground and saying, I mean business, and he's very angry with things. Or it can also possibly mean that he wants some deviations. It's something, you know, which is to his liking. And more than anything, it can mean that your communication with your child is so open that they have taken the liberty of telling you, you are the worst mama in this world. It does not mean that they mean it, but yes. What do such questions when they say mean to you? You may end up being sad, but don't beat yourself up. It is a statement which comes out of love, and it can also be a statement which comes out of open communication that you and he have. She also will know you, all included. Such questions and more. Mama, why did this girl come into my life? He's talking about his own sister. Am I adopted? Why are you so unfair to me? All these questions can be answered on Children's Day, 14th November, on FB Live and Instagram Live from 11 to 12. Addressing this talk is going to be Team Banjara, led by Dr. Ali Khwaja, who will answer such and many more questions to make your festival time with your bacha parties more enjoyable, full of love and understanding. See you there. Very good morning to everyone joining us today. Today's topic is, Mama, you're the worst mama in the world. As a parent, you must have heard it sometime in your life. We at Team Banjara, being hands-on mothers, in conversation with Dr. Ali, to understand what our children really mean when they say these statements to us. And also, what are they trying to convey to us? Hey, wait, not only mamas, even the dads and the papas hop on into this most insightful and enriching journey on understanding what children think and what they actually mean. Over to Dr. Ali.
Very good morning. Happy Diwali, happy Children's Day. Wonderful, no, to have both these things together. If we can focus our festivals, our celebrations, our life to the coming generation, because after all, they are going to rule the world tomorrow. When you are all very old and infirm and you won't know what to do with yourself and you become senile, it is these kids who are going to be ruling the world. So you better make sure that we give them a good upbringing so that they take care of us when we are old, right? So today we are going to talk about a few things about children, which normally are not given too much cognizance about. I have been on and off talking about the fact that children need to be taught how to identify emotions and how to express emotions, isn't it? You must have heard this from me many times. Those of you who are new, please hear this from me, because I believe in this very, very strongly, that children should be taught more than anything else. Teach them whatever subjects in school, curriculum, portions, exams, IIT, JEE, all those things are secondary. We have to teach from a very early age to every child how to, number one, identify emotions. A child should be able to identify and verbalize and say, I am angry, I am jealous, I am thrilled, I am curious, I am feeling very excited, I am feeling depressed, whatever it may be, the child should be able to. That's what we need to teach children. The second equally important thing is how to manage those emotions. Okay, but you are angry with daddy. I know, I accept it that you are angry with daddy. What do you intend to do about it? That anger is inside you. You need to get it out in a productive and a constructive manner, right? Okay, let's talk about how you bring out your anger, how you overcome jealousy, how you deal with sadness, all these type of things. So what we thought is that over a period of time, we've been hearing a lot of things about, you know, my child says this, my child says that, my child is rebellious, my child uses bad words, my child says nasty things, my child hurts me. This has been going on since a very, very long time. So today I thought, let us focus on this with real life situations, with mothers, even fathers, telling us what exactly happens to them, and let us discuss what the children mean. Okay, let us start with the first and very important aspect, that is, children do not have right and wrong in the moral sense, like how we adults have, no? This is morally right or wrong. This is ethically right or wrong. These are my principles and values and all these fancy words that we use, no? Children don't have that. Children, particularly younger children, have only two things in their mind. What is approved by parents and teachers? What is not approved by parents and teachers? Their whole world revolves around that. Am I allowed to do this? When it is a break, short break, long break, I can run in the ground, I can shout, scream, I can kick the ball, I can do. When the bell rings, I have to jolly well be sitting in the class, quiet and listening. When I'm at home, when nobody's around, I can tumble around on the sofa, I can jump up and down, I can go and hit my little sister from behind and enjoy her screaming. But when guests come, particularly when grandparents come, no way, I'm not allowed to do that, because my parents have to prove that they are very, very competent and efficient parents, isn't it? So I'm not allowed to do that. This is what happens in a child's world. I'll give you a very oversimplistic example to drive home the point, then we'll move on to actual statements that children make. Let's say there's this little toddler who's hanging around at home alone, single child, whatever it is. Daddy's gone out to work, mommy's busy in the kitchen. Child has been given, let's say, some paper, pen or some, you know, colored pencils or something. So what she does is that she sits down very meticulously, slowly, with great effort. She draws a nice, very sweet looking, cute Donald Duck. Okay, she colors it in and she makes the wings, she makes the legs, she makes the beak, all that is done. She goes and shows it to Mama. Mama is very impressed. Hey, fantastic. Oh, well, you are, you know, learned drawing within few days. You picked up so well, the coloring is so good, and you know, the colors are right inside the lines and proportions are good, all that, she says. Then as soon as daddy comes back from work, mama shows him, see, darling daughter, what a wonderful duck she has made. And daddy also praises and says, yeah, I think when you grow up, you're going to be a great painter and stuff like that. All that goes on. In the evening, some guests come and the same story repeats. See, 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 show to the guests, you know, what a lovely drawing our daughter has made and thing. And they also praise. The child day is made, she goes back to sleep very happily dreaming about Donald Duck. The next day, again, she's sitting with nothing to do. So you know what she does? She goes to the beautiful white wall in the drawing room and draws a big Donald Duck on the wall. And she said, now I'll get more praise. Anybody coming in will praise me. And parents won't even have to go inside and get that piece of paper. It's right here on the wall. But you know what happens to that poor kid afterwards? This is what I meant by saying that the child's world revolves only around what is right and what is wrong. Which also brings me to another very important point. Whenever, you know, elders complain that my child is telling lies. Why does a child tell lies? Again, as I said, truth and falsehood, lies and this and that are not the same as it is in adult world. To them, it is how do I maneuver through with my elders, my teachers, my parents, my grandparents, whoever I am answerable to. How do I get along with them without getting myself into trouble? So if I can conveniently tell a small little lie here and there, for which, you know, I escape punishment, why not do it? Because I know that otherwise I'm going to get a lot of punishment and things of that sort. The other thing is that when a child even starts speaking, it's very interesting. I was reading the other day about a research project. What are the first few words that a child learns? Usually it is mama, papa, these, that, whatever, you know, the common words which parents very proudly say that today my child said this, today my child said that. This survey showed that one of the first few words that a child learns is look, see, dekho, nori. The child wants the attention of the parent. So whatever the child sees, the child's curiosity is aroused. Anything new, the child just looks out of the window and sees somebody different standing on the balcony there, or sees a bird on the tree or whatever it is. And the child is not happy, you know, looking at it or enjoying that by himself or herself. The child wants the attention and involvement of parents. So the first thing that the child does is, Amma, Amma, come here, see, there is a bird there. Daddy, come and see, there's a big cloud over there which is looking like an elephant. Now, do we oblige the children? That's where the children's vocabulary is built. That's where the children's curiosity is appeased. And most important, that is where the parent-child communication becomes better and better. The child now knows, I can get the attention of my parent, I can talk whatever I want and things of that sort. There was a very interesting episode that happened the other day. You heard of that old movie called Sound of Music. In that, there's a very cute song, Doe, a deer, a female deer. You know, there was this little one who picked up that song. And she started singing, Doe, a deer, a female deer. Daddy heard once, twice, and said, what are you saying? Doe, a deer, a female deer. No, 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 it is female deer. You know, female means like a girl, you know. So a doe is a girl deer. So that is why doe, a deer, a female deer. You know what the child told the daddy? Daddy, it's my mouth. I will say what I want. I want to say female deer. I don't want to say female deer. Now, if you are a parent in that circumstance, what would you do? If you want this child to grow up fast, if you want this child to fit into all your adult ways of life, you would say, how stupid, how can doe be an email deer? There's no such thing as an email deer. People will laugh at you. You have to say female deer. Finished. The child's curiosity is gone, the child's creativity is gone, and the child's communication with the parent is gone. Now the child knows that I have to say only those things which parents approve. So most of the time what children do is they keep on saying what the parents will approve. And then they realize that whatever you do, parents have their own rules and regulations, teachers have their own rules and regulations. They're just not open to listening to what I have to say. They don't give me any importance, any credence. So I'm going to hit out. And it starts off with statements like this. What we titled today. You are the worst mama in the whole world. In fact, there are some mamas who get very jealous and they say, my child never tells the father you are the worst papa in the whole world. Why only me all the time? I think you should be happy that the child is giving so much focus to you and rather to the other parent and, you know, wants to give you that title of the worst mama in the whole world. There was another fellow who told his mother, don't come inside the school to leave me. You are the fattest mama among all my classmates. Imagine that poor thing, how she felt. But that is what child communication is all about, isn't it? I have been emphasizing day in and day out for donkey's years. Communication with children is spelled L-I-S-T-E-N. That's the only way to communicate with children. Let them say whatever they want to say. Now, what is it that they want to say? I asked many of our team members. I said, come on, not only your own child, you're all parents, but you may have heard your best friend, your sister, your others also saying about their children. So what are the things that they ask for? Let's see what children say and what they actually mean.
Hi, Ali. So sometimes I always wonder that suddenly Neil tells me, Mama, I'm old enough. I know what is good for me. It's my life. I'll decide what to do. And then sometimes I wonder that how can he decide for himself, you know? Still, I should take some decisions. So I really don't understand what he shares when he means.
I really appreciate children who say it's my life. I am old enough. I want to decide, because the whole objective of parents is to make your child autonomous. I keep telling parents, even with a small child, increase autonomy by helping him taking more and more decisions. It could be a simple thing like, do you want to wear the blue shirt or the green shirt today? Start with small things like that. The more you do that, the more the child will be happy that I am being treated as a grown-up. I am being allowed to take my decisions. But in small things, if parents start off by saying, no, I'm telling you that green shirt looks stupid on you, and not today, not for this occasion, that's a half-sleeve shirt, you wear a full-sleeve blue shirt, come on, you take it, another, and then, you know, you things are pushed in. That is when the child wants to know that I'm growing up. When the child says I'm grown up, what the child says is, I'm more grown up than what I was 1 year or 2 years back. So if I'm all of 8 years now, don't treat me like a five-year-old, treat me like an eight-year-old, and maybe treat me like a 9 or 10 year. Old. Now, all that you have to do at that time is, okay, let's see what decision you take in this. Encourage the child whenever the child says, I am old enough, it's my life, and things like that. That's a wonderful thing. Because many a time, we come across adults who don't take responsibility, isn't it? Adults who have grown up without proper upbringing and this and that, they've not had a good adolescence and things like that. They seem to be passing the buck all the time. They don't take responsibility. They're very irresponsible parents, executives, neighbors, whatever role they play. So here is a wonderful chance. Your own child is giving you an opportunity by saying, I am grown up. It is my life. I want to do what I want.
Yes, Ali, but he also says that you're like my stepmother. So horrible. Only Papa loves me. Only he understands what I'm saying. So how? Like stepmom, right?
Okay. Two things in this. One is, you have to very simply and plainly tell. You know what is a stepmother? A stepmother is a person there. Let's say somebody's mama dies and there is no mama. So what does Papa do? Papa marries somebody else and brings in a stepmother so that the child can have a stepmother. Now, unlike what you may have read in your small story books and all that, stepmothers are not bad. There are lots of stepmothers who are very good. They love their stepchildren and they take care. And daddy also has brought in their stepmother because daddy feels that I alone cannot give you enough love and affection and care and time. So here you will have another mommy, a new mommy, because you've lost your mommy. So I'm going to replace it. So in a calm and quiet manner, when the child is not in a bad mood, you first explain and define what a stepmother. And in the same breath, you say, unfortunately, I'm not your stepmother. I actually gave birth to you. And I have enough proof of it. I know how much trouble you gave me when you were in my tummy. You were kicking me from inside and all that happened. And finally, you came out into this world. Okay? So, even if you're angry with me, even if you're upset with me, you can say the nastiest things to me. But when I say that you have to eat the home food and you're not going to get a pizza today, I still stand by it. You can give me any labels you want.
Yeah,
Yeah.
Good morning, Ali.
Good morning, Sunita.
I have a really funny thing. My son says shit all the time, and I get really very irritated. And then he's like, this is just an ordinary word, mom. It's not a bad word. Oh my God, you're an 18th century mom. You don't know what people talk. He makes me feel as though, oh, I'm too old. Don't know what to do.
Yeah. See, let us differentiate between words which are at best avoidable and words which are definitely not to be used. You know that there are four-letter words. I need not, repeat it over this platform. But there are certain words which you, under no circumstance, will allow your child to use. Now, I think S, asterisk, asterisk, T is not one of them. Okay. It is a word which is best avoided, but it is not something so horrifying that you have to get scandalized if your child uses that word. So whenever you are in a situation like this where you have to discipline the child or restrict the child, the first thing that you do is to differentiate. So when the child uses a word which is absolutely not permissible, you make it very clear. Let anybody else use that word, whatever. You may have heard that it is common and it is done and all that. In our family, we do not use these words. And I'm making it very clear. Here comes another very important thing. Is there any elder in the family using that particular word? If they are, then we need to look inward first. If daddy gets angry on the phone with somebody and uses some abusive words, and if the child picks it up, you can't, help it. You know that interesting anecdote when the child came back and said that, today we started learning addition. For the first time, we have started adding numbers, and mama was very happy. Good, good, good. You're making progress. What did you learn? So she said, teacher taught us 2 + 2, the son of the bitch is 4. What? Yes, ma. 2 + 2, the son of the bitch is 4. Hey, how can the teacher say things like that? What do I know, mama? That is what she said. Mama got very angry. Next morning, she was there in the school and she says, what are you teaching the children? What happened? Teacher said, what happened? What were you teaching yesterday? They're teaching them to add 2 + 2. No, but what did you say? I said 2 + 2, the sum of which is 4. Now, the sum of which, how did it become the son of the bitch? Where did the child learn that phrase, son of the bitch? The answer is obvious. So, firstly, we have to look inwards and ensure that we do not use, at least the significant adults, let others use it outside. Let him, here on the road, we can always say that, yeah, people do a lot of bad things outside. We don't do it. Then you have to say, okay, even if your friends are using it and this and that, it is not something very advisable. Can you please minimize one odd time without realizing you get a little emotional and that word comes out of your mouth? I'll excuse you. But try to reduce it. I don't think we will appreciate these sort of things. The same way as, let's say I scold you, I raise my voice. You get upset, no? Don't shout at me. I also realize that I should not shout, but sometimes I can't control and I shout at you. If it comes to my notice that no, what I'm doing is wrong, then I can restrict myself. So the same way, we need to restrict ourselves.
I can understand. I will try to do that from next time.
Wonderful, and, wonderful.
But one other thing which my sister wanted me to ask you, she has an older son, and he was like, I just don't want to study. And all my friends say that, if I have weed, it will help me in concentration. And just without studying, I can like breeze through the exam. Right. Yeah. I mean, she is like stumped. She doesn't know what to say to him. If you could help us here.
Yeah. See, the internet, Google, etc., and all that has become a great source of information to the young generation. They are digital natives, as we call them. But we have to teach them what is right and wrong, what is to be acceptable from the internet and what is not to be accepted. There are these huge lobbies. I am told that there are many countries where the government is controlled by the drug lobby. The drug cultivators and distributors, they have so much money that they actually decide who's going to be the next president or prime minister of some of the countries. They're so powerful people. So obviously they control a huge segment of the internet also. So they keep putting in a lot of stuff. So the child comes back and says, you know, there's this International Institute of Health Sciences which says that weed is like this and ganja is like that and things of that sort. You say there's no credibility to that. Please do not get carried away by anything of that sort. We are very clear. If you want, next time when we go to meet the family doctor or somebody you know knowledgeable, come on, we'll ask that person what he has to say. And we are going to go by the word of reliable professionals and experts, not by something that you browse on the net. So first, let's resolve this problem. Is weed and you know drugs improving concentration and helping you in studies? We'll first work on it. Let us take time. Let us talk to a few people. Let us browse over reliable, you know, websites and all that, which are authorized by official bodies and things of that sort. Let's get into the, let's say, the website of Indian Medical Association, put this question to them and this and that, go through that process. Now, when you are convinced, let's talk about why education is important to you. And that becomes another big you know, long story, which you have to, on a continuous basis, keep motivating your child to study.
Thank you.
I had another query the other day from a friend of mine who said that, you know, the child said, if you force me to eat vegetables, I will run away from home. And the parents panicked. This fellow wants to run away from home. What is going to happen to us? I'm using that as an example because I was consulted on this just a few days back, but I want you to understand that this is what happens when a child is trying to indicate to you that I want your attention. This is what we refer to as attention-seeking behavior. Any of these very strong statements, you know, I want my brother to die. I want to run away from home. I want to kill myself. I don't want to live. These are all warning signs to the elders and parents that the child is seeking attention desperately. If you probe a little bit, you'll find out the reason why the child is upset. Go into that, and then you will realize that these words are not to be taken so seriously.
Yes, Ali, just coming, I mean, your point on seeking attention. Last year, I was visiting my sister-in-law and she has a six-year-old and a one-year-old, you know, the six-year-old son.
Right.
The other day, he was telling his mother, you always love only Nidhi. Am I an adopted son? Am I a stepson? More than anything else, did you pick me up from the road somewhere? So luckily, Ali, because I have done CCAD and, you know, I would, you know, I know a little bit more about children. So I asked her to just relax and told her the same thing. That yes, it seems like an attention seeking.
Exactly.
Just because he is the older brother, he's also six after all.
Mm.
So any more tips?
Absolutely. And you take this opportunity to talk. When he says, am I an adopted child? You say there's nothing wrong in being an adopted child. You are not. I know very well you're not adopted because I will never forget those 8-9 months when I carried you in my tummy. I know how much effort I had to put in. At the same time, it was a very happy moment because I wanted to become a mother. Go through that whole process. It will be a part of giving early sex education also to the child to understand what it means, where you came from, how children are born, and that also comes in. At the same time, it reinforces the fact, if he ever gets a doubt that am I, you know, somebody in unwanted or something of that sort, then you explain that there are other children who are not born from the tummy of their mama. They are adopted. There's nothing wrong. They are also children. Their parents also love them as much. So firstly, let's make it clear that if by chance you were adopted or something, my love for you would not be less, or you should not look down upon adopted children. Now comes the issue. When you say that you love Nidhi more and this and that, can you tell me what makes you say that? And inevitably, there'll be some incident behind it. You bought her a doll when I said I want to buy shoes. You didn't buy shoes for me. What you have to do is to clarify and say, I bought that doll for Nidhi because I felt that she has got less number of dolls and it was an occasion, Diwali was there, so I bought it. So you keep it aside, okay? Let's not compare. We never compare with each other. I don't say that, you know, you love papa, you don't love mama, or you love grandma or something of that sort. We should never compare, okay? Now let's talk about your shoe. So bring the child to the issue. Why I did not buy the shoe? Because I felt that your old shoe is good enough. It will last another 6 months, 1 year. It's too early to buy, and you're growing up. If I buy a shoe now, maybe next year, your foot will be bigger and the shoe will anyway be outdated. Whatever the reasons, and truthfully, please don't try to bluff your child. These are some of the things. Actually, you know what happens? The more you keep listening to your child, the more you start understanding these nuances, the more you read between lines and reach out to the child, the more you clarify, the time comes when you become your child's best friend. As the children grow up, those of you who still have children who are very small, I assure you that if you follow certain very basic tips and techniques, your children will grow up and they will one day be excellent friends. You may have other adult friends and all that, but the way children can become friends when they grow up is something amazing. It is something irreplaceable. We have had innumerable such occasions. I was in fact talking just yesterday, one of our old students, Shika, had come over, and I was talking to her about she feels now that both her children have become adults. So what is her experience and what does she feel about her relationship and what do the children tell her? The same children who earlier would probably say, you are the worst mama and this and that. What do those children say now? Would you like to hear directly from Shika? Here it is.
Kids call me a very children. Most times they do complain that I'm very childlike, and they get embarrassed sometimes, but then they're very, very happy to be in my company. They're able to share mostly adult things that, you know, generally parents don't share and, you know, don't discuss with kids. We are very free, I'm working with kids, we're free and open with each other. And it's been a very interesting journey with my kids, from being a helicopter mom to being a children mom. And I think most parents should take attempts to connect with their children so that we have a better healthy relationship. My kids call.
All right, so we reach the middle of section of our program. Please feel free to ask your questions from Dr. Ali. Here I would like to bring to your notice that like Dr. Ali was saying, that communication, listening, asking the child how you're feeling, you know, all these things are something which starts right from the time a child is really small. So you don't have to wait till the child becomes a teenager to start communicating about feelings. It can start right in the beginning. And for that, we have a program here, which is starting in December. It's called CCAD, like I was mentioning earlier also. It is Certificate in Child and Adolescent Development. So that is a program which completely focuses on 0 to 18 years age group, right from the time the child is in the mother's womb, the feelings and everything, you know, you would be surprised. And we have a panel of experts who take you through this program. This time we've got it online. Normally we have it here, but because of the pandemic, this time we've got it online, and we have a lot of people from outside Bangalore who are showing interest. Now this program is a 4-month online program. It will be on Mondays. There's a classroom session that's going to take place, and we will take you through varied topics, basically focusing on all the domains, the physical, emotional domain, and language skill development and everything, and also many other things like the importance of life skills, the influence of grandparents, or study skills, career in terms of the stress management in children, and several such topics. And when it comes to adolescents, you know, we'll take you through the girl-boy relationship, sex education, and many, many other things, multiple intelligence. So it's a wonderful program, like you can see in the poster. And if you want to know more about this particular program, please contact us and we'll be more than glad. The best part about this program is you will have a review session and you will have a mentoring session too. So after a few classes, there'll be a revision of whatever you have learned in the classroom. And so once a week, the classroom session happens, and another day in the week, which is, you know, mutually comfortable for the mentor and the mentees. We put 6-7 mentees in a group. Whatever is comfortable, that time what you can do is, whatever is being conducted in the class, you can brainstorm, thrash it out, do activities, discuss with one another. So it's an amazing program for teachers or anybody, you know, parents and anyone who is interested in knowing more about children. So back to Dr. Ali.
Time for your questions. Put it on the chat box.
Ali, I'll start with one question from a teenager's mother. Okay, she was really concerned. She came and says that, you know, my daughter was coming and telling me the other day that Sheena has a boyfriend. So is it okay for me, mom, to have a boyfriend?
This is how children test out their parents. If your communication has not been very good, or even if it was good, but the child has moved from being a child into a teenager, adolescent, and now wants to realign the equation and want to have a different type of relationship with the parent, more on an equal footing. I am a big girl now, that sort of thing. So when that happens, the child wants to know what are the reactions. Maybe the child has even heard mama talking to somebody else and just making comments saying, nowadays, you know, girls have all these boyfriends and then they land in trouble, or something she has overheard, and she's a little concerned that what about me? She may have identified a guy with whom she wants to get into a relationship, or she may be asking the question very in general. But please understand that this is the way a child tests you out. So what you have to do is to say, okay, tell me a little more about Sheila. Tell me more about what you mean when you say that she has a boyfriend. There are different, you know, definitions to it. There are friends who are boys, and there are boys who are friends, and then there are boyfriends. What do we exactly mean? At every stage of life, at every age, there are different definitions of it. So what did Sheila tell you? What does she do? She must be knowing so many boys. Now, why does she say that this boy is my boyfriend? Is there something specific about them? What do they do which she doesn't do with other boys? The more you make her talk, and then ask for her comments. What do you feel about it? Tomorrow, if you liked a guy, would you like to acquire him as a boyfriend? Would you like to give that label of a boyfriend to him? The more you ask, the easier it becomes. Shine says, my youngest son is 10 years old and most pampered one at home, but whenever something happens against his wish or we don't listen to him, he says that he will lose leave the house and stay with grandmother. I mentioned that a little earlier also. This is a type of threat which a child gives because the child doesn't know any other way of threatening. The child feels that mama or papa, whoever it is, are not listening to me. They are not giving me enough attention. They are not giving me a voice. I'm all of 10 years old. I'm not a small kid. So I want more attention. I want a little more, you know, freedom to take some decisions or whatever it is. You're not giving it to me. So how do I convince them? So there are children who say, I will run away from home. There are children who say, I'll go and live with grandma. There are children who even say, I will kill myself. I will die. I don't want to live if you behave like this. Take it seriously to the extent, not that the child is physically going to run away or cause harm to himself, but to the fact that the child is really looking for your attention. So stop everything. Pay attention to the child. If at that moment you are busy, you say, okay, I know that this is a serious matter and that you're feeling very upset. We'll do one thing. I'll finish off with lunch, then that person will go away, there'll be nobody around. We'll go and sit in the bedroom or in the balcony, or we'll take a walk outside, or we'll go to the terrace. We'll sit there and we'll talk about it. This is very important to me. When you say that, you know, you don't want to live and you want to go and live with grandma, we'll talk about the thing. That's all that it takes. And once you talk to the child will start opening out and a lot of issues will come out. Very similarly, there are children who make statements like, I'm stupid. I will never pass. I'm so clumsy. I am not like this. Here again, the child is looking for affirmation from the adult. The adult has not said it. Maybe you have said it unknowingly, sometime I have called him stupid or something. Maybe you have never said it also. But the child is throwing that at you to see whether you will counter it by saying, I have not noticed any stupidity in you. I have not felt that you are incapable of studies or passing or whatever it is. In fact, I strongly feel that you are very capable. I have seen certain areas. And then give specific instances where you had to learn something new and this and that, how fast you picked it up. It could be a simple thing like picking up a new game or picking up some new activity or something of that sort. How fast you learned about these things. That means you have that capability of doing it. So I don't want you to label yourself that you're stupid or clumsy or whatever it is, but I do understand that you have certain fears, certain apprehensions that I may not be able to do well in some exams or something. You know, I know that you're off late, you have not been scoring very well in maths, and maybe that triggered it. Again, make the child talk about it.
Right, Ali, another question which sometimes children ask is, they say to their mom, I want to tell you something, but you'll get very angry.
Yes, the child is again testing you. Now, a very wrong reaction would be, what is so great? What do you want to say? Why do you think I'll get angry? Do I get angry all the time? Don't take it personally. The child is just testing you out. The child maybe feels that this is something very unusual. This is something which normally is not acceptable to my parents. So now I am going to make that statement or ask that question or make a request. That's all. All you have to do is, yeah, sometimes I do get angry. No, I understand that sometimes I lose my temper. You can point it out to me whenever you feel that I'm getting angry unnecessarily. At the same time, even if I get angry, I'll be angry for a little while, no? After that, we are again going to be friends. So what's the harm? It's okay if I get angry once in a while. Come on, tell me what you want to do. You can diffuse the situation like that. Madhuri says, how to teach the importance of time to an 8-year-old. Everything needs to be told so many times, right from brushing teeth to having breakfast. Every sentence starts with, give me 5 minutes, and after 5 minutes, it is, that's so quick, 5 minutes, can't get over so fast. If I show him the clock, it goes to 10 minutes and the negotiation goes on. I don't think we need to keep chasing the child, because somewhere that probably, I don't know about your child, mother, but it does happen so many times, that the child is now using the parent as a crutch. That anyway, mama will come and help me brush my teeth. Anyway, mama will stand there and see that I drink the milk or whatever. And it is. So I'm not willing to take responsibility. Now here what you have to do is very simple carrot and stick. You brush your teeth in 5 minutes and come. I'm going to give you this, this, this. I'm going to in the evening sit with you and play that game of Ludo, or you wanted somebody to throw the ball at you so that you can practice your batting or whatever it is. So I'm willing to do that. Or I'll take you to the park on Sunday or whatever it is. At the same time, if you don't do it, there is going to be a punishment. In the evening, you watch that cartoon for half an hour. No, today you're going to be watching it only for 15 minutes. Because you don't have value for time, I'm not going to give you time. So we are going to do that. Carrot and stick slowly. Don't go on repeating the same thing, get ready, do this, do that and all that. Walk off from there and say, in 5 minutes, I'm expecting you at the breakfast table. If the child doesn't come, you have to say, today you're going to get this negative points for that. Sushma says, sir, my daughter is 14 years old and she was initially, but later now she likes my mother-in-law and goes to her for everything. She hates me. That's because she has been completely influenced by my mother-in-law. How can I overcome it? I think I'm going to her, but she always isolates me to get along with her. Loving her grandmother does not necessarily mean hating you. Please understand that. You are not a competitor to your mother or your mother-in-law. You are your child's mother, full stop. There is only one mother and nobody can replace her. So don't try to compete with affection with your mother-in-law. In fact, I would say for a child of this generation, she is very lucky that she has her grandmother. There's a lot of life skills learning that happens when children have their grandparents around, even if it is briefly. So encourage that. Now, even if your mother-in-law is teaching her certain negative things, don't go against that. Don't counter that. But at times be assertive and say, I know what I am doing. I am your mother. I am responsible for you. On the one side, I love you immensely. If she's the only daughter or something of that sort, you say that you are my only child or daughter. Even if there are two of them, you say that my entire world revolves around the two of you. So you are very important to me. But there are certain rules and regulations which I am going to impose. You can enjoy yourself with grandma, but I am still going to be the person who is going to get you into regulation. You like playing certain such game, no? Doesn't the coach make you do a lot of things? Doesn't he say you first have to run around and get into a sweat? Doesn't he say that you have to keep swinging your hand and practice this? Doesn't he say that you have to, you know, jump up and down at in one place, do spot running before you start with the game? Nothing. He doesn't do it because he hates you. No, he wants you to become a good sports person. That's why he's doing it. I want you to become a good human being. And that's why I'm going to continue doing this. Emma says, in these tech-savvy times, how to limit screen time to an adolescent? That is a million-dollar question, Emma. It's left, right, and center. Everybody is asking, and I have been constantly telling them, instead of policing a child and asking the child to reduce screen time, give the child some activities away from the screen which are attractive to the child. Time and again, I have been making lists of these things. Whichever parents have asked me, I have been forwarding that list to them. I have a list of 20, 30, 40 activities. You can create 100 more if you're a little innovative. In fact, if you involve your child in that process and you say, what do you like? Anything that you like to do, which is away from the screen, I want to discuss that with you. You want to go to the park. You want to practice your batting inside the house also. Okay, we'll take a small ball which is not very hard, which will not break things, or we'll go into this bedroom where I will remove all the breakable things, and then we'll play with this ball, we'll do something, whatever it is. Encourage the child. Sometimes it could be a simple thing like getting 3-4 pots, putting some seeds in that and telling, these are your babies, now you have to water them and you have to see the plant coming. When the child sees those plants sprouting and growing and gets that sense of accomplishment, that sense of pride, that sense of ownership, the child automatically starts getting attracted. So the answer lies not in pulling away the child from the screen, but gently nudging the child towards activities which are non-screen. Lakshmi says, so true. And I am one among that child who lived growing up with her. Whatever I am handling is only because of her. She's my strength. That's what happens. In retro, like how you heard Shika talking about how her children, you know, have become her friends, and now they say that you're the best and coolest mama in the whole world and things like that. One day you're going to enjoy. Just start practicing these things. And whatever we have been telling you today is not something very great where you have to put in a lot of, you know, efforts and these and that sort of thing. It fits into your daily routine. It is just that you have to keep changing your methodology a little bit, enjoying yourself, not taking your role as a parent, teacher, this, that, too seriously. Allow the children also to tell you certain things and to teach you certain things. Vanika says, my son keeps saying, you never listen to me, but I am all the time with him. Why does he say that? Okay, now we have been telling our counseling students all the time that there is a thing called passive listening, there's a thing called active listening, and there's a thing called supportive listening. Mama listens. Mama knows that even when I'm, let's say, driving the car or riding the bike, or I'm doing the cooking, or I'm catching up with some calculations and this and that, I'm still listening to my child. Okay? But what you're doing is passive listening, in the sense that the child is not happy. You're not making eye contact. You're not looking straight into the eyes. You're not smiling. You're not nodding your head. So take out quality time. If you're very busy, you're catching up with some office work or something of that sort, say so. That right now, what's the time? It's nearing 12 o'clock, right? 1 o'clock, I take a break. 1 o'clock, I'm going to spend, even before lunch and all that, I'm going to spend 15 minutes with you. I want to listen to what you are saying. And those 15 minutes, do not only active listening, do supportive listening. What does that mean? When the child is saying something, reflect back the emotions of the child. Tell the child, oh, is it? Howda, this is what happened, is it? Okay, yeah, yeah. Of course, that must have upset you very badly. Hey, that's great, man. You really must be enjoying that. It must be so thrilling to you. That is what we mean by supportive listening, supporting the emotions of the child. Venkatesh says, our son is a single child and he doesn't have the company of grandparents or friends due to the pandemic. Yes. He's at home most of the time, and when we are busy with our work, he plays on his own and keeps talking to himself. There's nothing wrong with a child, particularly a single child, talking to himself. A lot of children do that. They even have these imaginary friends, you know, they give a name and a title and a description to that friend, and they say, this is my imaginary friend and I'm talking to him or her, and you know, I'm enjoying jokes, I'm playing games or whatever. There's nothing wrong. But you do understand that when you have a single child and parents are working and you're not allowing the child to go out and play, you have to supplement it. So that's what I was just telling you, know that if, let's say, you get very busy at 10 o'clock with your work and till 1 o'clock you cannot get up, and if he's coming and asking you for certain thing, take a 5 minute tea break or something and tell him that at 1 o'clock, between 1 and 2, I'm going to be free. Half an hour goes for lunch, 10 minutes goes for me to take a quick power nap and to wash my face and all that, 20 minutes for you. And that is when we are going to have quality time, and we are going to discuss only things which you like, or we are going to do activities which you like and things of that sort. Emma says, my niece who's 16 years is very, very quiet and never speaks to anyone except parents. How to make her be social? One thing that you should not do is to force her to talk. The other thing is that whenever she talks, I was just mentioning to you, do active and supportive listening. The smallest sentence that she utters, immediately catch on to that. Firstly, turn around, make eye contact, go closer to the child and listen to her or something of that sort. And then take that as a mean. Supposing the child says that, you know, I don't understand this or something of that sort. You say, you know, our neighbor so-and-so auntie, they know, she knows much more than me. Come, let's go and ask her. When you go there the first time, don't force your child to ask. You ask on behalf of the child and say, you know, my daughter was asking this, 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 and she's not very clear. That auntie will explain. Do you understand? Do you have any more questions? Slowly the child will ask. Yes, auntie, but what about this? Ah, very good. Then you give her a lot of positive strokes. I felt so nice the way you spoke to that auntie, and openly you cleared your doubts and things of that sort. So don't push the child to talk, but encourage the child to talk and give a lot of, you know, positive strokes. Create situations where the child will feel like opening out and talking. Vanika says, my son also keeps saying his friends' moms and dads are more cool and wants me to be like them, and it hurts me. Parenting is not a popularity contest. You have no reason to compare yourself with any other parents. Jokingly, you can also say once in a while, don't do it very often, but once in a blue moon when you're in a very light mood. Yeah, that Rahul is such a sweet kid, you know. I wish Rahul was my son. Ha ha. Then you say, no, that's a joke, okay? I do not want Rahul as my son. I want only you as my son. You are my darling son, and I will not trade you for anybody. Similarly, I'm not an ideal parent. I accept it. Nobody can be an ideal parent, right? But you, one thing is very clear, you cannot exchange parents. parents are not like a tie or a dress that you can take the other guy's parents and say that they are cool, etc. Second thing is, a lot of people, I want you to learn this lesson of life, you know, it's part of the learning process. A lot of people are not what they project themselves to be. You have not lived in their house as their son, so you really don't know what goes on behind closed doors. Give some examples. The other day you were saying that, you know, this friend of mine, he seemed to be so friendly, but then I came to know that he is gossiping behind me and he is saying nasty things. Now you are very upset. So you see, earlier what happened? You thought this guy is great. The same way you may think that your friend's parents are very cool, very nice, but you really don't. On the other hand, when you say that they are cool or something, tell me what is it that you want from me? We cannot exchange parent, but I can try to be a little more cool, as you say. So tell me how I can become more cool. What is your definition of cool? What way you want me to treat with you and things of that sort? Okay, Fuad is asking you to throw light on the impact teachers have on children. Teachers are the, you know, step-in parents. So for those 4 hours, 6 hours, whatever it is, the teacher becomes the parent. The only difference being that parents are there exclusively to give you attention. The teacher has to divide her attention between 20 or 40 or 60 children. But teachers do play a very important role for sometimes good things which teachers say will remain with you as a motivation and inspiration all your life. Sometimes some insensitive teacher may say something bad. She may put you down, she may ridicule you, she may make some insensitive remark, she may compare you to somebody and it may hurt. I want you to please resolve that hurt by coming and talking to whoever you want to. It could be your own parent, that is ideal. In case you're a little hesitant, go to somebody else, any elder whom you trust and whom you respect and who knows, whom you know that will stand by you and say, this is what happened, my teacher said this and I'm very upset about it. Resolve it. Most of the time, teachers are just getting out their own frustration when they have to deal with their family at home and they have to deal with these 30 or 50 children in the class. They are answerable to the principal and the management. So sometimes, you know, unfortunately, some teachers do have a habit of bringing out their frustration by putting a child down. Don't take it personally. Shubha says, few of my students don't want to come to school. What will we do as teachers do? Motivate them to come, ask, find out why they don't want to come to. Children go wherever they find that there is something of interest to them, right? You ask the same child, do you want to go to Fun World or whatever, you know, something of that sort, and the child will jump up. Not only the child will jump up, if you say you have to get up and get ready at 6 o'clock in the morning, then only I'm taking you, 5:45, the child will be ready. So please understand that education also is so dry and, you know, so focused on marks and portions and syllabus that a lot of children get demotivated. Now, if you are a teacher, you can at least to some extent overcome that by making your classes interesting. 2 minutes in the beginning, 2 minutes in the end, 2 minutes in the middle. Laugh, joke, raise their curiosity, make them think. Connect whatever you are teaching to real life, how it helps you and how it's going to help you in future. Make it like an assignment or a project or something of that sort where they use their minds and they come out with answers. Stimulate their minds. The more you keep doing that, the more the children will feel like coming to school. And this is equally important because children have already been kept away from school for 8 months. We don't know how many more months children are going to be kept away. So this is a very, very important message to all parents and all teachers, that as and when schools reopen and children go back, you may have problems of the child not adjusting because for a long period, the child has been sitting at home. So please make sure that you start preparing your child, start motivating your child, start telling the child the good things about school, make him remember, recall, make him write down some charts, get a group of 2-3 of the classmates and make them all talk about, you know, what are the good things about school and what they are looking forward to when the school reopens and things of that sort. So please prepare them for it.
Ali, sometimes children get a little dramatic and say, why can't I get new games and toys? Are we so poor that you keep on refusing everything to me?
Yeah, that's where, you know, when the child makes some extreme statements like refusing everything, you can actually back it up with facts and figures. Okay, when you say everything, come, let's make a list. Let's go into your room and make a list of the toys that you already have. I bought this, I think, about a month back. This toy is 1 year old, but it's still very nice, and I see that you still enjoy playing with it. This child, this toy was presented to you by uncle, but you liked it and you have kept it. This other toy, I remember I had even asked you that, shall we gift it to your cousin? And you said, no, I want it. So first, let me clear it up that I do not refuse everything. Yes, I do refuse a few things. And it's not because we are poor. We do have the money. For example, I have money to buy a big car or to buy a bigger TV or to buy more gold or this or that, but I don't buy. We have to be frugal. We have to prioritize. We have to understand what we need and what we don't need. For the time being, you have to trust my judgment. Yes, if you do like a particular toy and you can convince me why you need it, or in general, if you can convince me that off late my toys have become very old and they're not very interesting, what are the new toys? Tell me what type of toys you want. Maybe if I can't do it right now, we'll do it for New Year, or we'll do it for the next festival, or we'll do it when the exams are over, when you have vacations or something of that sort. Make it a continuous process. The final word in all this is that it's a very continuous process. I wind up by telling you what I had told you in the beginning. Number one, listen to your child. Number two, make your child talk about his or her emotions and how the child will manage those emotions. Number three, put the ball back in the child's court and say, yes, I understand that you are very worked up and that is why you're saying I will run away, or you're not buying me anything, or you are the worst mama, or whatever statements you're making. I'm accepting your emotions. I'm not accepting the statement that you're making, but I do understand that it is hurting you very badly and that's why you have brought up this. Come, let's talk about it. The more you communicate, the more you allow your child to talk, the more are the chances, as we mentioned about Shikashi, that's only one example that we gave you, that your child will grow up and become an excellent friend to you, and you will learn to enjoy the growing up, the growth, the progress, the happiness, the joys of the child. That is what life is all about. So let us make that resolution today, because not only it's a festive day that is Diwali, but it is also Children's Day. They deserve a lot from you. So go ahead, enjoy this long weekend, start building up better communication, make your child talk anything under the sun. In fact, if you're very busy, make a note of certain statements that your child is making. And when you are free and when you have more time and things are cool, bring up that statement or question which your child had made and review again with the child. So have a wonderful time. Thanks a lot and bye bye.
Ali, you say goodbye from Team Banjara.
Okay. Yes.
Okay. All right. So, on behalf of Team Banjara, I think we should wish you all a very happy Diwali and
a very happy Children's Day and a very happy Diwali. Have a nice weekend, guys. Yeah, have a wonderful weekend.